Happy Monday. It is your girl that's just charm. I'm all festive. Yep. And we're gonna jump right into this video. So just drop my introduction, please. How are you guys? How was your weekend? How was Valentine's Day? What did you guys do? Are you single? Did your partner take you out? Did your husband, your wife, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, like, did y'all get any gifts? Did y'all send me any gifts? Why would never send me any gifts? That's what I want to know. That is the main question. Yesterday was Valentine's Day, and no matter how you spent it or whatever you did, I am almost 100% sure that if you're watching this, your Valentine's Day was not as bad as Susan Hamilton's. This case is not a Jamaican case, you know how it goes, but I really wanted to talk about it because, hello, it's the season, I guess. So we're going to jump right into it. Susan Hamilton was a trophy wife by all accounts, and her husband, John Hamilton, was a very lucky man. I couldn't find much on the couple's life before they met. I couldn't find anything about their childhood, their upbringing. I couldn't even find their birthday, okay? But what I do know is that they were recently divorced before they met each other, and each of them have two children from their previous marriage. Now, back in 1985, John, he was 37 years old. He had just recently been divorced and he was ready to mingle. Or maybe he wasn't, I don't know. And Susan, she was 39 and she also had recently been divorced. Now, John and Susan met at a mutual friend's birthday party, and there was just an instant connection between the two. Sparks went a-flying, you know, the usual case. Susan was not only beautiful, stunning woman, she was also smart and outspoken, and this just drew John in more and more, and he fawned over her. Every single body said that John was head over heels for Susan. 2 years later, after the couple met, they got married at a local country club. At their wedding, John surprised Susan with a Porsche. John was a romantic and he loved Susan. They had created the perfect life for themselves. They had beautiful cars. They had a huge, beautiful mansion. They were really loving towards each other, and it seemed like they were a match made in heaven. And fast forward to 14 years later, he was still surprising her with gifts and trips. And everybody that knew this couple said that they were so perfect and they were literally the model couple. Everyone wanted to be like John and Susan, or wanted to find a husband like John, or wanted to find a wife like Susan. That's how perfect this couple was. But obviously, if they were that perfect, this wouldn't be a crime and conviction episode now, would it? John, well, Dr. Hamilton, to his colleagues, was an OBGYN. And in addition to delivering babies, he also ran an abortion clinic. Susan helped him out with the clinic, and she was there 2 times a week. Being that they ran this clinic, as expected, they made enemies with anti-abortion protesters. However, Susan was not intimidated by this. She was very outspoken about women's rights and, you know, the right to do whatever they want with their bodies. And this seemed to bring them closer together because John stood behind her 100%. Fast forward to February 14th, 2001. This would have been the couple's 15th Valentine's Day together. John went home in between surgeries that day to pick up his date book, but some sources said that John went home to give Susan some flowers. Either way, what he came home to was a very horrific scene. Firstly, when he came home, he realized that his back door was wide open, but he didn't think anything of it. So he went inside and he went upstairs. He was calling for Suzanne. He didn't hear her. And when he went into their master bathroom, Suzanne was lying on the floor in a pool of her own blood. Suzanne's face was swollen. It was unrecognizable. And there was two neckties that was knotted around her throat. When John saw this, he was shocked. He was frantic. He was in distress. And of course, he did what any human being would do in this situation. He took up his phone and he called 911. Now, I don't have the actual recording of the 911 call, but I can summarize it for you guys. John gets on the phone with the 911 operator and he's just like, please, please send police or send an ambulance. The operator asks John what's the problem, and John says that he thinks his wife is dead, and he told the operator that he's a doctor and he was trying to do CPR. The operator asked if she's not breathing. John says no, she's not breathing and he's not getting a pulse either, so they should please hurry. The operator then asked if he's doing CPR and he said that he's trying and he's going to hang up the phone so he can continue doing CPR on his wife. When the paramedics finally arrived, it was a sickening scene. Suzanne's hair was wet and she was undressed and she was lying on the bathroom floor of the master bedroom in a pool of her own blood, as I said before. So you see, earlier that day, Suzanne had to meet up with a friend at about 9:30. So it seems like she was getting ready to do this when she was attacked. Suzanne's face was swollen, unrecognizable, as I said before. She was strangled with two neckties and parts of her brain was exposed. That's how bad her head was bashed in, like her skull literally was cracked. The paramedics noted something strange. The doctor wasn't doing CPR right. No, he was just pumping her chest and her stomach. He did not do any mouth to mouth. And to confirm that he didn't do any mouth to mouth, Suzanne's face was swollen and it was bloody, like blood was everywhere. So if he did that, there would have been some form of blood on his face, but there wasn't. When police finally arrived to the scene, they didn't really know what to make of the scene because it was so violent and it was so brutal. They didn't know if it was a robbery, if it was an intruder, if it was a break-in. They really didn't know what to make of it. Now, after the police did their rounds, they started to zone in on the anti-abortion groups. Now, John and Suzanne, because they ran the abortion clinic, they would often receive threatening emails, threatening texts, threatening phone calls from members of this group. Also, their house had been vandalized before. But a week before the murder, they were handing out flyers with John's face on it saying that he's wanted dead or alive. And they even faxed one of these posters to John's office. And I think it was 2 days before the murder took place, they tried to set fire to the abortion clinic. The police wondered if this was the group's way of sending John a message. Evidence was missing from the crime scene. There was no murder weapon. And strangely enough, there was bloody footprints inside the home, but there was no footprints outside the home. So it's obvious that the killer left because there was no murder weapon and there's no one hiding in the house. So how did the killer manage to leave this gruesome scene without getting footprints outside? In all domestic cases, the police have to look at the spouse. The police questioned the couple's family and friends, And everyone, every single person that they interviewed said that John would not have done this. John loves Susan. They're the perfect couple, you know. Everyone except for one person. Now, Susan had a neighbor that she confided in, and she said that she thought that John might have been having an affair. Now, John was getting constant phone calls from someone, and he would be ignoring the calls. So when Susan inquired about this, John just said, hey, you know, it's a patient, they're kind of needy, just leave it alone. So when Susan did some extra checks, I think she got the phone bill, she saw that there was over 100 calls to this number, and she found out that this number belonged to a stripper. I don't know how she found out or whatever, but she did. Now she confronted John, and John said that yes, she's a topless dancer, however, they're not having an affair. She really is a patient of his. She's just down on her luck right now. She doesn't really have any money, and he's helping her out with some depression medication. He didn't cross any lines, and if she thought that he crossed any lines, he apologized. So obviously the police had to look into this. They did. They even interviewed the stripper, and she said that, listen, there is definitely no affair between me and this man. And they couldn't find any evidence of an affair either. I mean, the only thing that they found was the phone records, and that's not proof of an affair. Like, how are you gonna cheat with just phone records? I mean, maybe he did cheat and was really good at hiding it. In John's car, they found a Valentine's Day card from Susan to John, but it wasn't really lovey-dovey. The message in it was a bit strange. So what Susan wrote in the card was, I bought my card 2 weeks ago, so they don't seem so appropriate now. I love you. Have a good day. And also, an open Valentine's Day card to Susan from John was discovered in the kitchen during the investigation, and this said, I know this has been a difficult time for us. We are important, loving, caring people together. My life would be incomplete without you. I love you, John. So the authorities saw these letters. Does not seem to be a perfect marriage, but the thing is, John had a pretty tight alibi. Now, he had surgery scheduled that morning for 7 a.m. at an outpatient clinic. So he got up, got ready, and then he went to that surgery at 7. That surgery was finished up at about 8. He was talking to a friend till around 8:30. Then he stopped home. Now, it wasn't strange for John to stop home because he lived in between the outpatient clinic and his regular office. So when he was back and forth, he would sometimes stop home. So he stopped home for whatever reason, and then he went to his regular office for another surgery that was scheduled for 9. He did that surgery. Nothing seemed strange. His co-workers were interviewed, and they were just like, yeah, he seemed all fine and all right. And then he came home at around 10:30 after that surgery was finished, and that is when he found Susan. So John essentially had around half an hour free time, and not even half an hour because he had to be traveling during this time. So he really didn't have any time to kill his wife, or so it seemed. So they weren't really looking at him that much, at least not yet. Now it's time for John to give his formal statement. So obviously the police needed to take him down to the police station, but this is when John started to display some very strange behaviors. Now, there's a mesh screen that is between the back seat and the front seat of a police car. John started to scrape his fingers on this mesh, for no absolute reason, and he also started to pound his head in the mesh. It was very strange, but the police didn't question it. When they got to the police station, they had to take John's clothes for evidence because, you know, this is the clothes that he found his wife in and everything. There's blood on it. So they took his clothes. And when John took his shirt off, that is when they saw some scratches and scrapes on John's shoulders and, you know, over his body. And the police kind of put two and two together and they're just like, wait, is that why he was like pounding his head and scraping his fingers so he could cover up the scrapes that he had on his body? Anyways, this was coincidental, but the police had nothing to hold John with. So he was just there in the interrogation room waiting. When the authorities did extra checks with John's colleagues, his alibi was not as tight as they thought. Now, John's second surgery that was scheduled for 9 a.m. was delayed because John was late. It was delayed to 9:45, giving John well over an hour to commit the murder. So 53-year-old John Hamilton was then arrested for the murder of his 55-year-old wife, Susan Hamilton. His trial started in December 2001, and this trial was very difficult because there was no motive, there was no murder weapon, John had no past arrest, and everyone that they interviewed except for the one neighbor said that this marriage was so perfect and nobody ever even saw John angry. Because of this, the trial was mainly based on blood evidence. Susan's blood, hair, and skin, well, actually pieces of her flesh, was found on John's steering wheel, his seat, and his car door. So John's explanation for this was, after he came off the phone with 911, he realized that his vehicle was blocking the entrance to his house. So he stopped doing CPR, went downstairs, went outside, got in his car in his, you know, bloodied clothes, and he moved his car, and then he got back inside and continued doing CPR, which is the stupidest thing I've ever heard, but that was his explanation. This is what the prosecutors believed happened that day. They theorized that Susan gave John the letter when he was leaving out for his first surgery. While on his way there, he opened a letter. So after his surgery, he stopped home, as he usually does, and he tried to patch things up with his wife, but she definitely was not having it. They might have gotten into an argument, and she might have mentioned divorce, and this probably triggered John. So he waited until she was in the bathroom to get ready for her 9:30 meeting, and he just grabbed his neckties and he went ham. He just strangled her and started beating her with an object. They don't know what the object is, but he just started bashing her head in, and then he tried to clean up. Now, a wet rag was found on the scene, and they believed that John used this wet rag. He tried to clean up, but then the hospital buzzed him at 9 o'clock because this was the time that he had his surgery, but he was not there. When he realized that it was 9 and that he was going to be late for his surgery, he took off his bloodied clothes. He wrapped them all up with the murder weapon, probably put it in a bag, and then he went into the bathroom to take a shower. Then he let the water from the tub run down a bit so it could get rid of all of the blood and everything that was inside of the shower. And then he poured some form of cleaning solution down the drain to get rid of the blood that would have been left in the drain, right? Got ready for work and went downstairs, turned the heater up a little bit more so that the tub could be dried out so that they wouldn't know that he took a shower in the tub. Then he left, arrived to the office, went into his surgery like normal, like nothing never happened, like he did not just bludgeon his wife to death. And then he went back to the house to discover his wife's body to make it seem like he was innocent. So that is the story that the prosecutors gave. Is it far-fetched? Not to me. It seemed very feasible. This story would actually explain the missing murder weapon because he would have packed it up to take it with him. And it would also explain the lack of certain evidence that was inside the house. John's defense team hired a blood spatter expert. And when this expert was on the stand, he said that because there's no murder weapon, it's kind of hard to determine certain splatters. However, the splatter on John's shirt that they took for evidence was consistent with someone giving CPR. However, when this expert was cross-examined by the prosecutors, they asked him if there was any evidence that was overlooked or if there's anything that he would like to share with the court. And this man threw John right under the bus. He said that yes, there was some blood evidence that was overlooked because on John's shirt sleeve, there was some blood on it. However, the blood was going the opposite direction. This is consistent with someone bashing something over someone's head. How the hell would he know that? I have no idea, but that's why he's the expert. His trial lasted for 7 days. The jury went and they deliberated, and when they came back, he was guilty, and then he was later sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. And today, John is still in prison. It doesn't look like he's getting out anytime soon. He's in a maximum security prison. Now, that is all the facts that I have for you guys today, and I'm just gonna give my thoughts. This case is very strange to me because of the lack of evidence, like the motive part, like why the hell would he do it? Until John actually comes out and says why he did what he did, nobody will know. This crime was gruesome. So there was no history of abuse in John's past, nothing. So what could it have been to make John just snap, lose it, and like beat the shit out of his wife? Like, what could she have said, or what could she have done, or what was the case, like, you know? And then the second strange thing to me and to everybody else was the fact that this man just committed this gruesome murder, like blood everywhere. His wife's face was swollen, her skull was cracked, and he went and performed surgery like everything was normal, because that's what his colleagues said. Like, everyone said that nothing seemed out of place. Is that not strange? I just find it so freaking strange. Out of all of the days to kill somebody, especially a spouse, you kill her on Valentine's Day, bro. It's crazy. The story is crazy. It's a whole roller coaster ride. I know that you guys have thoughts. Feel free to leave them down in the comments as per usual. I will be linking my sources down in my description box if you guys want to read up on this story for yourselves. Also, please follow me on my social media pages. Those are linked down below in the description as well. Anything else I have to say? Of course. Remember to be a beautiful soul, not just a gorgeous face. And until next Monday, bye. Have a wonderful week. Oh, shit.